Well, it's good to introduce our guest speaker today. He was involved in teaching our teachers all yesterday, and not only weekday education, but also our small group leaders as well. And we're so fortunate that he stayed over today. Wes Stafford grew up in a small village in Africa where he witnessed at least 50% or about 50% of his boyhood friends dying something to do with poverty, as he found out later in his life. So 36 years ago, he started Compassion International, which hopefully he's going to refer to in just a few moments, as I will as well. And then also, he's the author of two different books, Too Small to Ignore and Just a Minute. And he's been married to his wife, Donna, for 35 years. They have two daughters. One is on Broadway, and the other one is a place called Madagascar. Anybody ever heard of that? You know, there's a ship there, a hospital ship that she serves on, and so she's involved in ministry. It's just wonderful to introduce him to you today, and he's going to give us, hopefully this morning and prayerfully, a greater heart for the world. And so, Wes, if you'll come now, Dr. Stafford, let's give him a round of applause as he comes today and delivers God's word to us. Bless you.
Thank you, Pastor Mercer. What a privilege to be here. I've looked forward to being with you here in the First Baptist Church. You guys are a great friend of Compassion. Many of you are sponsors of our children, and I want to say thank you on behalf of those little ones. You're doing an amazing thing. I want you to know that I don't think you can get closer to the heart of God or closer to the priorities of His kingdom than when you reach out to children in poverty in Jesus' name. I love the spirit I feel in this place already. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. I watched how you sang that. I am the son of missionaries who went all the way to Africa to spread the gospel. Can you imagine my joy that today, I can tell you, within the ministry of Compassion, 400 children are going to give their lives to Jesus Christ. At the knee of their pastor or in their Sunday school classes, across 26 countries of the world, 1.5 million children, maybe your child, will accept Jesus Christ as their Savior this very day. We only work through little churches, 6,500 churches where the gospel is going forth. To put that 400 in context, I know this to be true because it happened yesterday and it will happen again tomorrow. It happens every day of the year. Last year, 145,000 little children gave their lives to Christ in the ministry of Compassion. What would that look like? Well, I'll tell you this. Between now and next Sunday, when you gather in this sanctuary, the number of children who are going to accept Jesus Christ this week would fill every seat in this sanctuary. 2,800 children will give their lives to Christ. So you're a part of that. You're a part of that. And I want to say on their behalf, thank you very, very, very much. This church has a great heart for children. I've seen that. I met with your teachers yesterday. Remarkable, remarkable people. They love your children. And if your children are a part of their class, you are blessed people. I saw more tears, I heard more laughter, I heard more plans, more passion around the children that these teachers are teaching, and you're blessed to have them. I feel compelled this morning not to talk about Compassion, not necessarily even tell my own story of why I care so much about the poor, but I feel compelled to take you straight into the Scriptures, right into the most precious passage of Scripture I know that talks about Jesus' love for little children. When it comes to children, we don't need our WWJD bracelets. What would Jesus do? We need our WDJD bracelets. What did Jesus do? And what did He tell us to do? And so let's jump right into one of the most precious passages of Scripture I think that exists. You all know it so well. The passage about Jesus and the little children. This is a very beloved passage, but it's also a very dangerous passage to misunderstand. And it is widely misunderstood. To misunderstand it is to risk missing the very heart of Jesus for the little children. So let's jump right into this. It was one of 1,000 mornings that Jesus spent with his disciples. In the 3 years that he spent with them, he walked with them, he lived with them, and this is one of those mornings. The scriptures tell us there were other signs and wonders that Jesus did that didn't make it into the scriptures. But this story made it in 3 times. All 3 of the synoptic gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, felt compelled to tell this story because it was such a shocking thing that happened to them that day. In the context of the Jewish and the Roman society, children really didn't matter a great deal. In fact, in the Roman society, a family, if a little baby was born into that family, the child was laid on the floor in front of the father. And he had a choice to make, 2 things he could do. He could either pick that child up and assume responsibility and raise that child, or he could just as easily step over that child and walk away and abandon that child entirely, and nobody would condemn him for it. Children were really a second-rate mandate in the context in which this story goes. And so for this to make it into the scriptures 3 times, something happened here to get the attention of the gospel writers. It was no ordinary day. And you know the picture of how this went. You probably remember it from Sunday school. There was Jesus. He was surrounded by religious leaders, scribes and Pharisees. There were his disciples there, as always. And there were mothers with their little children that they had brought for Jesus to lay his hands on and to bless them. This was an interesting setting. Do you know what they were talking about in that gathering? They were talking about divorce and taxes. Can you imagine, you Sunday school teachers, trying to keep the attention of your children when grown-ups are talking about divorce and taxes? And so as you might well imagine, children got a little bored with this. Children got a little bit rambunctious. The disciples, being new leaders, took it upon themselves to say, shh, children, grown-ups are talking here. When that didn't do it, they then turned to the mothers and said, they rebuked them, why did you bring these children here? And eventually, they must have said something like, would you please just take them away? And you know the scenario. Jesus was sitting there talking with the leaders of surrounding about him. And he must have seen this going out of the corner of his eye. And he said those precious words that we love, so gentle, so meek and mild. Oh, let the children come to me. Don't hinder them. Of such is the kingdom of heaven. Right? No, wrong. Really, really wrong. Dangerously wrong. That is not how it... I have 2 big problems with that scenario as it has been presented all through the years. The first one isn't all that important, but the second one really is. The first one is, he didn't look like the way we show him so often in our pictures of him. Art galleries across the world, sculptures, paintings, poetry, have all tried to capture the sacredness of that moment. And usually what we present is, I'm looking for the picture of those of Jesus with the little children. What we usually present is this meek, mild, little, tender, weak kind of looking guy. He's sitting there with soft, white linen robe. His hands are petite and feminine. His hair is wonderfully coiffed and mysteriously backlit somehow by some kind of halo. His skin is absolutely white and very, very fair, and he looks thin and he looks frail. And I ask myself, how did we get the idea that Jesus, who grew up in the Middle East, looked like that? And I've come to the conclusion that in the fullness of time, it must have been because it was before the paparazzi. Nobody actually took a picture of Jesus. It was before Instagram, Facebook. Jesus never took a selfie. Although there was artwork all across the Roman Empire, nobody apparently ever so much as stopped to paint a picture of Jesus. His disciples didn't so much as get a little piece of charcoal and sketch Jesus. So we never got a real historic picture of Jesus at the time that he was alive. And historians tell us that hundreds of years passed before we ever actually got the first portrait of Jesus. And it probably came out of medieval Europe, probably Western Europe, where somewhere a nobleman of some kind must have wondered, what did Jesus look like? He found a starving artist, I think, and he said, paint me Jesus. Now, I said he was a starving artist, not a stupid artist. So he must have thought to himself, well, nobody knows what Jesus actually looks like, so why don't I paint Jesus to look like the guy who's going to pick up the tab? And I'm sure when he presented this picture of Jesus, the nobleman must have said, wow, I had no idea Jesus looks just like moi. The people of Western Europe, the aristocracy particularly, took great pride in the fact that they didn't do manual labor. They didn't even go outside if they could help it. They loved the fact that they stayed out of the sun. They loved that they had pale, white, blemishless skin. They wore fancy clothes. They were wealthy people. And they had people who would actually coif their hair. And that is what wound up in our artwork. But that's really wrong. You see, Jesus was a carpenter. Jesus was a man's man, a strong, robust man. I grew up in a little village in Ivory Coast, West Africa, with no electricity. And our strongest guy in town was our carpenter. He worked with manual labor guys. It was before Black and Decker. And Jesus worked for 30 years as a carpenter with cedar and olive wood. And it was, yeah, don't need any of that. Carpentry work is difficult work. And he was a hard-working man. You have to understand that he was fully God and he was fully man. So I maintain that there must have been scars on his hands before the cross. Can you imagine? I mean, if he's a carpenter, sooner or later the hammer slipped, don't you think, and he hit his thumb? The question I ask myself is, so what did he yell when he hit his thumb? I mean, you don't yell your own name. You don't go, Jehoshaphat. I mean, what do you yell when you hit your own thumb? Well, he was a rugged outdoorsman. He had no place to lay his head. He had nowhere to dry his hair. He had nowhere to iron his robes. He had warm, twinkling, sparkling eyes. And when people saw him, when children particularly saw him, they knew that he loved them. His complexion was dark, if not from ethnicity, from being outdoors all day, every day. So he didn't look like the historic pictures we have. But that's not the important point. The more important point is he didn't sound like that. He didn't coo softly and gently. He roared in great anger. You stop that. You let those children come to me. Don't you dare hinder them. That's my kingdom standing there. Really? Yeah. Mark 10:14 says it this way. He was irate. I love the way the Message says it. He was irate, and he let them know about it. He was angry. He was furious. I don't know about you, but I have never seen that artwork. How dare you drive these children away from me? Well, you wonder, did Jesus have a bit of a temper? Did he lash out in a temper tantrum at the moment? No, I don't think so. Only twice do we really know that Jesus was angry. And both times, it was because important things in his kingdom were being attacked. And both times, it was premeditated. It was something that had been on his mind for quite some time. We all know about Jesus driving the money changers from the temple, don't we? We know the rage that he had in that moment. But that didn't happen in an instant. We're told in Mark chapter 11, verse 11, that Jesus was in the temple the day before, and he saw what was going on there. His heart was stirred, but it was too late in the day to do anything about it, apparently. And so he walked for 5 miles to Bethany, and he spent the night with Mary and Lazarus and Martha, his friends. He must have tossed and turned all night in his hurt over what was going on in his father's house. And the next morning, not having slept well, he woke up in a bit of a mood. And I bet you he took off of that 5 miles. His disciples couldn't keep up. We know that he was in a bit of a mood because he came to a fig tree and he wanted some breakfast along the way. The fig tree didn't have anything, and he said, you're cursed. If you don't have anything for me now, you never will have anything for me. And he plowed his way on into Jerusalem. And when he got to there, he turned over the money tables. He had a whip and he drove out the worst scoundrels in all of Jerusalem. This is how I know he wasn't that wimpy little guy. These guys ran from this powerful, outraged rabbi. And he was upset because prayer and worship was being replaced by business and corruption in his father's house. Well, this is the second time he is angry, and it's because something as important as children are being pushed out of his environment, out from in front of him. But was this premeditated? Had he thought about this before he actually exploded in that moment? I think so. For that, you have to hit pause in this story, and you've got to go back to the night before. You go back to the night before, and Mark chapter 9, verse 33 tells us what was going on. They had walked from Capernaum that day, and on the way, they had argued the ugliest argument in all of the history of the world. The disciples were arguing among themselves, who is the greatest in the kingdom of God? And it was such an ugly argument, so broke Jesus' heart, that he couldn't even walk with them, apparently, that day. How sad is it when Jesus cannot walk with us because what's in our heart? But when they got to Capernaum, Jesus said to them, "What did you argue about on the road all day today?" And they were ashamed, but finally they admitted, "We were arguing about who is the greatest." By the way, that argument made it into all of the Gospels as well. Now, Jesus must have thought, "I've got 1 week left with these guys. I have poured myself into them for 3 years. And they've got to understand this thing called humility. They've got to understand this thing called servant leadership. Am I really going to wash these unworthy feet this week?" The question I have is, how did that argument start? And I think to understand how that argument started, you've got to go one day earlier still to Matthew chapter 17. They were at the Transfiguration, and they watched as this remarkable thing when Moses and Elijah came down and ministered to Jesus as he set into his final week. And Peter, James, and John were witnesses of this, and they went back and reported to the others. And the question must have arisen, really, Moses and Elijah? Where was David? Where was Abraham? Where was Samuel? Are there more important people in the kingdom of God than other people? How did this work? And they fell into this discussion of who is the most important, and they looked at each other and must have thought, well, who of us is the most important? And they got into a really, really sad argument that I think might have gone something like this. I can imagine Peter saying, "Well, I'm the rock. I'm sort of the vice president around here, don't you think, guys? Have any of you ever walked on water?" No, I didn't think so. I can imagine Andrew saying, "You know, whenever we play a game and we pick up sides, we always choose the best first. He chose me first." I can imagine Judas saying, "We're trying to build an enterprise here, and I am the only guy that understands finances." And I can hear Matthew saying, "Yeah, buddy, anybody can count the beans. I'm the only fundraiser around here. Okay, the only thing I raised was taxes, but still." Simon the Zealot could have made a case, "Don't you think the name Zealot says it all?" And John the Beloved said, "Yeah, I think names matter, but I think Beloved trumps Zealot any day of the week." Thomas might have said, "I doubt that you understand my full qualifications here." James might have said, "I'm his brother. I'm his little brother. Yeah, Peter, you tried to walk on water. Do you know how hard it was for me following him around as a little boy? I nearly drowned." Okay, I could be totally wrong about that argument, but we do know there was an argument, and it led to a very powerful moment in Matthew chapter 18. We read about what Jesus said when he understood that they were talking about who is the greatest in the kingdom. And what he did was he called a little boy. Some people think, some historians think it might have been Peter's son, but he chose a little boy from the fringe of what was going on there and had him stand there between his knees in front of these ego-driven leaders at the moment. And they must have looked at this little boy and said, "What's this, Rabbi? We're talking about power and prestige and position, and you bring this little boy here? What's this?" And Jesus, being the great teacher, said nothing. We don't know how long that little boy stood there, long enough for the gospel writers to say a child stood in their midst. And they must have began looking at that little boy like they had never looked at a child before. And when Jesus had their full attention, then he spoke. Verse 3 of Matthew 18, and he said, "Unless you change and become like little children, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. Don't argue about leading in the kingdom of heaven. You won't even be there unless you change and become like little children. You ever been in a grocery store when the mother's frustrated with a little child and she says to her, would you just grow up? Well, Jesus is saying to his disciples, would you just grow down? You've got childish figured out. What I need in my kingdom is childlike. And that word change, you must change, is the same word used for Saul turning to Paul on the road to Damascus. In other words, a complete paradigm shift. You've got to become a completely different person, like a child. He says in verse 4, whoever humbles himself like this little child is the greatest. And I'm sure the argument on the road had a lot to do with who could do the most for Jesus. And Jesus puts that to rest when he says in verse 5, whoever welcomes a child welcomes me. And in Matthew 25, he said almost the same thing. Whatever you do for one of the least of these, you have done it for me. Not to me, or not on my behalf, but actually to me. I think of the sponsored table out there where some of you might want to sponsor one of our children today. And I think if Jesus is saying what you do for a child in poverty, you're doing for me. I imagine if we had a folder on that table, which was Jesus, and we had the usual write-up. His name is Jesus. He's the son of a carpenter. We think there's a lot of potential in him. I think when we say amen from here, there would be a holy stampede to run out there and sponsor Jesus. But when you sponsor one of these little ones, the kingdom says, that's exactly what you're doing. Mother Teresa said it well. She said, the poor are Jesus in distressing disguise. Here's what I love. They have been talking about who's the greatest. And then Jesus, this great rabbi in verse 6, loses his train of thought. He forgets what they're talking about because he totally in an instant changes the subject. And he looks at them and he says to them very carefully, by the way, don't you cause one of these little ones who love me to stumble. That's not what they're talking about. How did Jesus suddenly get onto the importance of this little child when they're talking about greatness in the kingdom? I'm convinced that what happened is this little boy is now standing between Jesus' knees. Jesus is probably looking at the back of his head, and he fell in love with this little boy all over again. He must have thought, I remember knitting this little guy in his mama's womb. I know how many hairs are on his head. I know how many... The pattern on his fingerprints is I feel them trembling on my knee. He's uncomfortable being in this spotlight. And Jesus fell in love with that little child all over again. And he said, you would be better off with a 2-ton rock around your neck. Okay, that's not scary enough. A 2-ton rock around your neck and thrown into the depths of the sea than to cause one of these little ones to stumble. Can you understand how incredibly important these little ones are to me? And oh, the way we cause little ones to stumble. Verses 7 to 9 of Matthew 18, he moves on a little bit in his thoughts, and he says, if you've got these kind of sins in your life that might cause a little child to stumble, here's an idea. If it's your hand, chop it off. If it's your foot, cut it off. If it's your eye, pluck it out. Don't you dare cause these little ones to stumble. And I can imagine the disciples saying, whoa, 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 Jesus, we're not those kind of people. We wouldn't do that. You know us. And then Jesus gave them a very powerful passage that we almost never think about in our churches these days. But it's verse 10 of Matthew 18. And Jesus said, I know that, guys. The disciples were going to forget this next verse in the next 12 hours. And we as a church across the world have forgotten it in the last 2,000 years. And here was the bombshell. He says, okay, then don't even look down on these little ones. Because I tell you this, their angels in heaven ever see the face of my Father in heaven. Don't even look down on them. They might be small, but they have huge advocates. I don't know all about the scenario of heaven. I know that there's the Father, there's Jesus at his right side. I know there are martyrs, I know there are saints, but apparently there is a cluster of angels, children's angels, their angels, in the presence of this great power, this great awesomeness. And they must have the ability, why would they be within eyesight, ever see the face of my Father, unless they have the ability to interrupt what's going on? And I think when a little child prays, their guardian angel must come to the Father and say, excuse me, we just heard from a child. And if I understand the priorities of the kingdom, everything must hush. And I can hear God saying, well, what is it? And I can imagine the angel saying, it's a little girl in Orlando, and she's praying it doesn't happen tonight. And I can imagine God saying, all right, you take your sword, your spear, you stand beside her in next to her bed, and you protect that little angel tonight. If we could see the guardian angels, these big behemoths, I mean, what is the first thing an angel ever has to say to a human being? Fear not. I know I'm big. I know I'm scary. Fear not. If we could see the guardian angels of the little children, there would be no abuse. There would be no neglect. We would have our priorities in the right place. He then goes on to finish this conversation in verses 11 to 14, talking about the lost sheep. Now, this is a very precious passage of Scripture, too, and usually we teach it as the value of the individual. But Jesus still has a little boy standing between his knees. He's still talking about children in his kingdom, and I know this because in verse 14, he ends that discussion of that story of the going after one lost sheep by saying, because my Father in heaven is not willing that any of these little ones should be lost. Now, how did that conversation end? I don't know. Maybe the disciples melted away like the Pharisees with the stones and the woman caught in adultery, but I'm guessing that it wound up with just Jesus and this little boy. And I can imagine this little boy looking back up at this big, strong Messiah and saying, wow, I guess you told them. You were trembling. And I can imagine Jesus saying, yeah, I suppose I was. You have no idea how much I love you. Okay, now, you can fast forward to the next day where we began, and there's Jesus and the little children. I happen to have a feeling that this was not the first time Jesus did this. This young rabbi from town to town probably had these kind of gatherings often, and he was ever alert to the children around him. I'm pretty sure that he saw this little girl with a flower in her hand and thought, for me? I remember creating that. I can imagine he sees this little boy playing peekaboo from behind Peter's robes, and he's like, hi, and he's talking about divorce and taxes, and the disciples get a little irritated. Jesus, we're building a kingdom here. Would you focus? You are surrounded by the power. These are the opinion leaders, the change agents. Hone in on them. And so sure enough, you know how it goes. Shh, children, grown-ups talking, children, please go away. And that's when Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, our Messiah, our Redeemer, explodes in anger. And he says, no, don't you dare do that. You let those children come to me. That's my kingdom standing there. Don't hinder them. Interesting, he didn't say, bring the children to me. He said, let them come. They will come to their Creator, to their Savior, their Redeemer, if you just don't hinder them. So the children came into the arms of Jesus. I'm sure there were mothers who watched their children now in the arms of Jesus, and tears must have been flowing down their cheeks thinking, that's all we wanted, Jesus. We just wanted them in your arms. We wanted you to bless these little children. If you go to Compassion's lobby in Colorado Springs, you'll see a sculpture that I had commissioned of Jesus and the little children from all across the world. But in the center of that is Jesus with a little child on his lap. You're looking down on it there. A little child in his lap, but his other leg is empty. And I arranged for the robe folds to be like a stepladder for little children to be able to climb up and actually sit in our lobby in the lap of Jesus. And I come in some mornings, and on those couches around there, I see mothers looking at their little children sitting in the arms of Jesus and tears streaming down their face, much like these mothers. And the reason I did that is I wanted to create a memory in these little children's minds. I wanted them to say, I remember when I was really small sitting in Jesus' lap. Where was that? And I want their mama to say, honey, that was Compassion International, where you sat in Jesus' lap. One of the things you owe your children more than anything is memories. So Jesus took these little children into his arms, and he blessed them. What did he say? Oh, this breaks my heart, but none of the gospel writers captured the words of what he said in blessing over these children. I think they were too shell-shocked by what they had just been through. They just had their priorities all discombobulated. So I can imagine what Jesus thought. He must have said, I am so sorry for the evil of this world you must endure. It is so far from what my father and I had in mind for you when we knit you in your mother's womb. I love you so much more than anyone seems to understand. I maintain if we actually knew, if we had red letter edition of what Jesus said in that moment of blessing, there would be no question about the importance in our churches and in our mission efforts. And our teachers would be the heroes among us. And we would understand the most important thing most of us are doing is the children that we're raising. That's what happened in that setting. It's not the last time, though, that we see these children. Five chapters later, Matthew 21, verse 15. It's the triumphal entry. Some of the same scribes and Pharisees, no doubt, and some of the very same children. But this time, they are welcoming Jesus into Jerusalem, and they are waving palm branches, and they are shouting, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And this time, it's someone else's turn to be indignant, not Jesus, but the scribes and Pharisees. And they come in verse 15 and they say, do you hear that commotion? Do you hear what the children are shouting in the temple? And Jesus must have smiled and said, oh, yes, 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 I do. Isn't it wonderful? And he quotes from Psalm 8, out of the mouths of babes and infants, you've ordained praise. And he might very well have added, and don't you dare try to stop them. Because if you do, the very stones will cry out. What's the heart of our Lord toward children? How angry does he become when they are hurt and neglected and abused? What does God expect of us as grandparents, as mothers and fathers, as neighbors, of church members, as leaders? I can tell you, as I've walked around this campus, he would be delighted in your passion for children. What about children that we will never see on this earth, like the children on the tables out front? Life on this earth is going to be about that long, and we will spend all of eternity. And I urge some of you who have not yet sponsored a child with us, you can do this. There could be a good chance for a child to accept Christ as their Savior and to be discipled to reach their full God-given potential because of you. And it is so close to this heart of God. So how are we supposed to live? Well, I think we're supposed to be different and we're supposed to be better. We're told, be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Be transformed from the inside out. I think we are called on as followers of Christ to see things differently, to think differently, to feel differently, and ultimately to act differently. Because this world is not our final home. We are just traveling through here. It's a campsite, people. Whenever I go backpacking in Colorado, I don't put a big fancy foundation under my tent. Why not? Because I'm not going to be there that long. If we listen carefully, we march as followers of Christ to a different drummer. We have a different set of priorities. We hear a different beat. Everything about our kingdom is upside down. The first are last, and the last are first. The weak are strong, and it's the strong often who are weak. The poor are rich. The servant is, in fact, the greatest. It's through surrender that we achieve victory. It's not about me, it's about Christ. And in the kingdom of our God, the little are big. And may God bless you as you bless the little ones of his kingdom. Amen.
Let's bow for a moment in prayer, and as we pray before the Lord, before we pray, let me just say that if you're here visiting with us today or you've never made a decision to follow Christ, all this is about just that. We are looking at the world, and we have a burden for that. I think we've proven that as a church many times over and over again. And if you don't have that burden today, perhaps it could be because Jesus doesn't live in your heart right now. And you know that deep down, that you feel that, you sense that this morning. And so I want to give you an opportunity to trust Christ the way we have done that. and to trust Christ the way we're praying that children all over the world will do. And so as we bow in prayer right now, if that's the condition of your heart, I want you to confess in just a moment that you are a sinner, that Christ died for you, that he rose again on the third day to conquer death and to conquer sin for you. And you're going to trust him as your Savior and Lord as you follow him in your life. With heads bowed and eyes closed, would you pray that prayer with me silently as I pray out loud? Lord Jesus, Lord, we thank you for all that you've given us. And God, right now, I confess my sin before you. I ask you to forgive me of everything that I've done. I ask you to come into my life. Be the Savior of my soul, Lord of my life. Lord, I want to follow you, and I want to make a difference. In Jesus' name I pray.